Thank you for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to speak in such a large auditorium. I'm going to talk about the geopolitics of tourism and mobilities in the ASEAN region. I edit a journal, academic journal called Mobilities. And in terms of this, I came to investigate the ASEAN region in terms of geopolitics, which hasn't been used much in tourism studies. I work as a professor of tourism at the Metropolitan University. The idea of tourism geopolitics has been defined in terms of the way in which we view the world, how the global landscape is structured, various nation states, this informs us informed by various foreign policy agendas of different governments. Such discourses make their way into the everyday representations of the media, and of course, then into tourism. The media will see various representations of different countries in maps, books, films, television programs, cartoons, and increasingly websites, which portray stereotypes of different countries. In terms of tourism, foreign policy discourses have a profound effect on the way in which tourism, for what reason, people are able to access international borders. Geopolitical discourse and scripts are showing the variety of institutional and popular media as powerful as they divide the world into conflicts over the space and resources. Websites are increasingly powerful actors on the geopolitical scene. Walid Hasbun, in his book, has been at the forefront of linking the analysis of tourism with geopolitics in his analysis of contemporary Middle East. He argues that while international tourism remains an overlooked topic in the vast political economy, literature, and globalization, the expansion and transformation of international tourism has long exhibited many of the core features of what's become come to be characterized as globalization. Tourism drives the transnational flows of people, commodities, and capital, which circulate the globally coordinated production networks owned by large transnational firms, such as airlines, tour operators, and hotel management companies. International tourism also operates literally on the leading edge of globalization by continually transferring consumer tastes, cultural practices, business people, and capital across the world. He goes on to demonstrate the importance of tourism development strategies for the wider geopolitical agenda in Middle Eastern countries, such as the United Arab Emirates. Rayon Bianchi, on the other hand, has analyzed relationships between tourism, freedom to travel, and the geopolitics of security. He argues that implicit in much of the contemporary geopolitics is a Western liberal ideal discourse of tourism as freedom, freedom for some and not for others. He argues that while places such as hotels, motels, and airports may signify liberating sense of freedom and cosmopolitanism for some, where the boundaries of nationality are temporarily suspended by the geographies of travel, remains created by gender, sexuality, ethnicity, class, and increasingly religion. He writes of how tourism and particular destinations can be drawn into political conflicts when accumulated local grievances and wider geopolitical imperatives collide. Moreover, when tourism becomes even more closely intertwined with global geopolitics and the mapping of global risk, threats to security through the mechanism of state travel advisories, advisories such as the Foreign Commonwealth Office in the UK, extremely powerful in portraying a dominant Western worldview. As we know, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations was founded in 1967. And in terms of geopolitics, the primary aim was to promote peace and ensure stability following the Vietnam War in the late 1970s. After that, the association really turned towards economics. In 1976, a treaty was signed to strengthen the economic cooperation and mutual assistance between ASEAN members, and since then most of the alliance's efforts are focused on shared economic issues. Tay and Tai and Thompson have further argued that, though ASEAN has developed into an increasingly robust supranational frame of reference, scholars and others have cast Southeast Asia, particularly ASEAN, as an elite project, primarily a framework for diplomatic exchange, interstate relations, and regional security. Leaders and institutions ASEAN have undertaken various efforts, such as education, curriculum initiatives, and news media collaborations, in order to promote the idea of an ASEAN the vaccine as a social, cultural, political identity. They go on to argue that Thai students have a strong sense of Southeast Asia as a coherent region of associated countries, more so perhaps than other vaccine countries. As ASEAN's economic emphasis is most often focused on trade and manufactured goods, minerals and fuels, tourism is growing to an important consideration. Consideration in large part due to the rapid growth of the tourism industry in Southeast Asia. No, the original treaty did not consider tourism. It did encourage member states to take cooperative action in their national and regional development programs to extend the complementarity of their economies through increased mobilities. In 1987, the Manila Declaration agreed that intra-ASEAN travel would be encouraged among member countries where a competitive and viable tourism industry should be developed. In 1992, ASEAN members agreed to increase the cooperative efforts in tourism promotion. In 1995, the Bangkok Summit reinforced the need for more networking in all service areas, including tourism. It also emphasized the need to provide integrated transportation and other infrastructure, preserve cultural and natural resources, simplify border crossing procedures, and human resource development. In 1998, member states recommitted themselves to collaborating by passing a plan of action on ASEAN cooperation and tourism and establishing a ministerial understanding on ASEAN cooperation and tourism. And most of these efforts in the past have been geared solely towards marketing and promotion. Efforts were also made to consider border-related tourism issues as well. Meetings in 1999 between tourism ministers of all 10 members reaffirmed their commitment to work together on tourism on a regional basis. One of the primary goals of the ASEAN Plan of Action for Tourism was to build a holistic image of the region as one vast and appealing destination that will provide a wide range of experiences for potential hosts, tourists. According to Dallin Timothy, this effort is beginning to pay off. While many barriers still exist in other aspects of tourism, such as policy and environmental management, marketing and promotional efforts are the strongest part of the ASEAN partnership in tourism. With encouragement from the ASEAN Secretariat and the ASEAN Tourism Association, member states began to surrender the traditional competitive approach to tourism growth in favour of a complementary relationship with other member nations. This was manifest most vividly in efforts to promote the whole region as a single destination, as with the ASEAN Tourism Forum logo, packages and attractions to conduct other image building and regional activities. These efforts started with establishment of the Subcommittee on Tourism, which was charged with a range of regional marketing endeavours. While SCOT was dissolved in the mid-1990s, it's a good example of the early attempt to build regional marketing efforts. The establishment of the ASEAN Centre demonstrates a continued interest among ASEAN members to promote the Carrizo region abroad. However, despite this, very few other pan-ASEAN policies pertaining to tourism have been formulated. Most of it has been to do with marketing. Nevertheless, ASEAN tourism is forecast to continue to grow. In 2008, the region received 65.5 million visitors, almost double the figure in 2002. According to the United Nations World Tourism Organization, Southeast Asian region expected to experience an average annual growth rate of 6.3% between 1995 and 2020. By 2020, the regional arrival figure is projected to reach 136 million per annum, illustrating the growing importance of tourism and the interdependence between ASEAN nations. The 2002 ASEAN Tourism Agreement, one of the objectives is to facilitate travel into and within the region. What has been achieved so far is the signing of the 2006 Visa Exemption Framework Agreement, which allows ASEAN nationals to travel within the region without the visa. As Wong et al. Argue, the goal of facilitating visa procedures for international travellers has not been realised due to the reluctance of governments to relinquish control in areas that are sovereignty-related. Another issue identified on the national level is the lack of coordination among government agencies. Tourism is a sector which requires cooperation. Nevertheless, the movement of people in the ASEAN region is not just about tourism. From a mobility perspective, it's also about a number of other issues connected to tourism. In terms of tourism mobilities, we've got this idea that global tourism needs to be situated within more local concerns about everyday transportation to our cultures and special relations, as well as with more technological concerns about mobile information and communication technologies, and moves and infrastructure from security and surveillance. And I'm just going to finish there because I think I'm running out of time. Okay? I've got other material, but I think it's a good place to stop now. Okay? Thank you very much.